I want us to read some text. I'm not going to go through the whole story because I have a sermon on that that we've done before. But turn in your Bibles to Esther 4. And I'm going to give the background to the story in a few minutes. And we're going to get into a very important point. I call this a time of purpose. A time of purpose. And it says in verse 13, "And Mordecai told them to answer Esther." That's the ones who came with the message. "Do not think in your heart that you will escape in the king's palace any more than all the other Jews. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this." Verse 15, "And Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, 'Go gather all the Jews who are present in Shushan and fast for me, neither eat nor drink for 3 days or night. My maids and I will fast likewise, and I will go to the king, which is against the law. And if I perish, I perish.'" Father, I pray that you help me to share these words the way you intended. Let it be living. God, we're not here just to hear words. We're here to sense the Spirit, what you're trying to say to the church at this time. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I've been thinking this week, and for many times this week, I said, "God, what do you want me to share?" And I said, "Joy." In the back of my mind always was this, and I kept saying, "No, I've shared on this before." But what I wrote today has almost none of the old notes. If you want to hear more about Esther, you can get that. But I want to come into that, use the story as a starting point, but we're going to talk about our time of purpose. How many know we can misunderstand our purpose? I humorously read about a truck driver who was hauling 500 penguins. Unfortunately, his truck broke down not far from the zoo. So another truck came by, and he took $500, and he said, "Now, what I want you to do is take these 500 penguins to the zoo. Can you do that?" "Okay." He gets the truck fixed, and he's driving to the zoo, and he gets almost to the zoo, and he sees the man come out with all these 500 penguins just following him. He said, "What are you doing? I gave you $500 to bring him to the zoo." He said, "I did do that, but I have money left over, so I'm taking them to the movies now." How many know he didn't know his purpose? His purpose was not just to entertain them. How many know one of the most important things you can do in your life is to discover your purpose and your value? I put those both together because it's important. You're not only just your purpose, but your value. And this is a sermon that could take a couple days, but please just let me just take a little time today. We're talking about you have a purpose and you have a value. The question is, why am I here? Or the question, even more important, do I matter? You ever felt that way? Do I really matter in the scheme of things? Do I matter? Somebody once said this, I believe it was Barclay. He said, "There are two great days in a person's life. The day they're born, and the day they discover why they were born." That's pretty good. You see, because when we talk to people about Jesus, we always say to them, yes, Jesus loves you, and he has a plan for your life. God just does not love us and leave us. He loved us, as we'll discover today, and before you were ever born, he had a plan and a purpose for your life. And unless you discover that purpose, in which none of us, if I asked you what's your exact purpose, we're all finding part of it, aren't we, as we go. But we have the road we're going on saying, I want to follow the purpose of God. The life of Esther brings this out very clear. And I want to draw some points from it without going into great detail. But there's four major lessons we learn in the book of Esther. Number one, we learn that God has a plan for our life. Number two, we learn that Satan has a plan for your life. Nobody ever told me that. God has a plan for my life, but the devil has a plan too. Have you noticed that? Yeah. Number three, you have a choice which plan you're going to follow. And number four, God is the only one with the real answer. Now, the background to our story, and just give me indulgence for a few minutes to just talk about this, because it's quite a fascinating story. I love Esther. It's a short story, only 10 chapters long. We see God moving behind the scenes, even though his name is never mentioned in it. It is one of history's most fascinating stories, written 500 years before Jesus. And Esther begins about 37 years in your Bible by Nehemiah, many of the people return back to Israel. There's millions living there, and only 60,000 return. Now, that's a different subject for a sermon, but the ones that remained, they remained there. Now, the king that was the king at that time, our Bible calls, we have his name in Hebrew, Ahasuerus, and it's also known in history as King Xerxes I. Now, this guy was getting ready to make the greatest military battle in history at that time, with about 2 million soldiers descending upon Greece, where he won. Now, before that, he decided to throw a party. Now, this king, when he threw a party, he didn't throw it like Chris does. When we went to his party in his backyard, he had a bouncing castle and some barbecue, and everybody went home after a few hours. This party was 6 months long, almost. How many like to go to that kind of a party? I don't know. That's a long party. He gathered all the people from 127 provinces. This was the largest country in the world at that time. It was the largest power in the world at that time. It stretched from northern Africa to India. And at the end of this feast, he had 7 days of extra drinking. And, of course, the book of Esther's full of all different feasts. Well, at the end of it, he decides to have his queen come in, and he says to King Vashti to come in, and he wanted to show her off. And the text brings out that she would come out, maybe uncover her face, which was not supposed to happen in front of all the others, or do something, but she was a woman of integrity, and she refused to come. Now, you didn't refuse this guy, especially when he was drunk. So she refuses, and all the other men get together and they tell the king, now king, if you don't do something about this, all the wives in the kingdom are going to disrespect their husbands. And so what they did is they had her kicked out as queen and had them set up a proclamation that the man should be the head of the house. And the king said, this is good, until he got lonely. Until he realized what he did. He says, I think I had a little bit too much to drink that day. She wasn't all that bad, really. And so he was lonely. He could not reverse what he had said. She was banished. And so he had his own bachelor TV program there with no TV. Remember that? I never watched this Bachelor, Bachelorette. But he had this beauty contest. And this beauty contest was kind of, well, I tell you, this guy, you're the head honcho, the king, man. You go through the whole country, and you bring in all these beautiful women, and this was a bachelorette program, but it was not that good. Because number one, when the Bible tells us in chapter 2, verse 12, this is something for you ladies to think of. Because I know some of you ladies, when I talk to your husbands, they'll say, my wife takes all this time to get herself ready. Be relieved that you didn't live in that day. 1 year they took to get ready to meet the king. That's a long time. 6 months that they would have like certain perfumes and 6 months with other oils. And the thing that was not good about this beauty contest is the high point of it is you get to spend one night with the king. And if he liked you, then maybe you might be queen. Didn't like you, you were punished, you were set in with the concubines, which often never met the king again their whole life. They're behind the walls, they're just in that community, and it was a life that was all not that good. So that was the setting of the story. And there was a man called Mordecai. Mordecai means little man. And this little man became a big man. If you feel like you're little, let me tell you, God will make you big. And then there was a man we read about called Haman. Now, Haman hated the Jews. And he hated Mordecai. He was a second in charge, and he wanted everybody to worship him. Everyone to bow their knee, but Mordecai wouldn't do that. Now, Mordecai, which we're going to, like I said, I can't go into great detail, but Mordecai was a righteous Jewish man. He was the cousin of Ruth, Esther, and he raised her. Now, let me tell you something. God has a plan for your life. We'll discover Esther's in a minute. And Satan has a plan for your life. Right. Satan's plan through Haman, he wanted to destroy all the Jews. He went to the king, and he says, okay, king, there's a people here who will not bow their knee to you. Well, actually, it was to him. And this is the clincher. He says, I'll give you, and he says, all this silver, 10,000. Actually, you know how much that was in money today? About $55 million. Some say $30 million, but the modern rate, counting is $55 million. He says, I'll give you all this money if I can get rid of these people. Now, $55 million, or 10,000 of these silver that they had, talents, was roughly 60% of all the money that came in the kingdom at that time. So the king was motivated. Now, he didn't even know who these people were. He didn't even ask who they were. All he said is, oh boy, this is money, okay. I'll give you my ring. And Haman decided to kill all the Jews. Let me just answer this question. Why is the devil trying to kill the Jews all the time? Why does the devil hate the Jews? We see it all the way back, don't we, from Egypt when they tried to kill Moses. We see it in Bethlehem when they tried to kill all the babies at Bethlehem. It's because in the garden, as we discovered, that God made a plan of salvation that it would come through the Jewish people, as we found later in Abraham. They'd come it, and he thought, if I could kill off the Jews, I can stop this Savior from coming. How many know the devil couldn't do it? And the Jews are still there today. Hallelujah. He tried it in history. We see it all through history. What happened? Because the devil, according to Jesus, it says he came to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life, said Jesus. So here's the stage of this famous story. God had a solution. God knew when trouble was going to come upon the Jewish people. Say amen to that? He knew. So he had prepared this girl, Esther. She didn't know it, which we'll discover. And we get the verses we read. Let me read it again. Mordecai knew now that she'd become queen. And he sent messengers. And he says to her, you got to do something. Do not think that your heart will escape the king's palace any more than the other Jews. Now she probably would have been protected there. He's speaking that what you sow, you reap. God watches things. But he knows that the end, that something would happen. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. Where? I like to ask him one day, where would it come from? But God has a way. Amen? Amen. Yet, let's go drop down. Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this? And we sing this, we talk about for such a time as this, but the question came in my mind this week, what kind of a time was it? What kind of a time did she come into? We always have romantic pictures. Oh, wonderful for such a time. All the good old days. You know, I remember those good old days weren't so good. The grass is always greener on the other side of the septic tank. You know what I mean? You know, what kind of time was Esther in? And this is important because some of you today saying, I don't know my purpose. I feel I'm pressed down. I feel I'm unjustly. I don't have a good job. I don't have a good family. I don't have a good thing. How can God use me? Let me tell you about Esther's time. She was a slave, nothing less than a slave, to this Xerxes I. He was the son of Darius who put Daniel in the lion's den, Meshach, and Abednego in the fire. Okay? She was literally forced into this sensual bachelorette thing to find a to find a wife. She was an orphan. Her mother and father had died when she was young. This girl seemed to have everything against her. Her cousin is the one who brought her up, Mordecai. Women's rights were absolutely at a zero at that time, especially after Queen Vashti, when they sent the proclamation. You know, the proclamation said, when this decree is published throughout the king's vast empire, husbands everywhere, whatever their rank, will receive proper respect from their wives, blah, 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 blah. How many know it wasn't a good time to be an orphan, slave, beautiful woman? How many know if she were just going to sit there and say, oh, I wish I was born in a different time. I can't believe what I'm in. But she didn't realize that for such a time as that she was born. We cannot look at the exterior to see what time we're in. We cannot say, oh, I'm living in a bad time. Let me tell you, you're living in the right time. Because God puts you here now. We say, why was I born in this time and not the good old days? Our life situation may be unfair. We may have lack of purpose and we may feel empty. But the problem is the real purposes are hidden in God. We're going to discover that. What is the key? Number one, you got to understand that God doesn't make mistakes. Let's say got to pick on somebody here. Lester. God says, oops, I made a mistake. He was supposed to be born in the 1800s. He was supposed to be a gunslinger. There, he's already saying. How many of God doesn't make a mistake? If you believe in an omnipotent God, you believe in a God who's infallible, which we do, he doesn't make a mistake. We may, oh, I wish I was born in Dickens' time. No, you don't. You have to believe that God is in charge. In finding our purpose, we must trust God's plan for our life. We must trust God's plan for our life. Why, think of Esther, why would God make me born to a Jewish minority in the Persian Empire where the people don't like Jews? Why would God make me an orphan? Why would God, why become a single woman instead of a man? Why should I be this poor girl, this slave girl in a foreign land? The reason was, is that because she was a Jew, because she was an orphan, because she was adopted in the circumstances, it had propelled her to be one day the queen of that country. If she was a man, she never could have been queen, right? If she had been born not a Jew, she would have cared about the Jewish people now, would she? God knew exactly what he was doing. There is no accidents with God. He knows every detail of your life. I call this love with purpose. We say that God loves us, but he loves us with a purpose. I love this verse. I want you to see this on the screen. Ephesians 1, 5 in the NLT. It says, God decided what? In advance. What's that mean? God decided in advance to adopt us to his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. I declare that God, before you were born, looked down, and he decided in advance who you are, that he loved you and gave you a purpose. Oh, I love it. You were created not only with a purpose, you were created to be part of God's family. As the verse we just read, it said that he was bringing us to himself through Christ, that he might adopt us into his own family. Church, you were not only purposed to be in God, you were purposed to be in a specific part of the body of Christ. Now, how often do you hear that? The Bible says that he places us in the body as it pleases him. In America, one of our weaknesses are that we have these constant church-hopping people that never make roots, and as soon as somebody looks cross-eyed at them, I'm going somewhere else, and then they end up in the first church of the cross-eyed people anyway. How many know it's okay to look around and find God, where do you want me? But when God speaks to your heart, I want to plant you here. And as soon as there's a problem, as soon as there's a little tribulation, we run away. And what happens is we don't realize that God has placed us for a purpose in that group. Maybe that purpose is you're an intercessor. Maybe that purpose is you're a giver. Maybe that purpose is that this just to smile and encourage people. How many know we need that? Let me go on. God never allows anything in our life by accident. Let me say that again. God never allows anything in our life by accident. If I belong to God, it's not an accident I'm born at this time. The Bible tells us in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those that are called according to what? His purpose. Notice the word purpose coming up again. You're called for a purpose. He has a purpose for you. You know, people say to me, Pastor, why do things go wrong? I'm in this situation, in this marriage, in these problems. Some of our problems we have created. Let's be honest, right? You know, you went and bought that car and you felt in your heart, I shouldn't buy that. And then you did it anyway, and it turned out to be the biggest lemon they ever made in the lemon factory. Then we say, God, it's your fault. No, he said, I said, wait. Has that ever happened to anybody here besides me? But in the whole realm of God, where God is working in our life, he does not know how to hurt us. He has purpose. And he gives us purpose. And things will work together for good. How many times people have said to me, well, I can't find a better job. I'm looking for a better church. I'm looking for a better wife or husband. I'm looking for a happier life. You will never find it until you realize that it's not people, circumstances, and surrounding things that give you your happiness. It's Jesus Christ. Amen. And as you get him in your heart, you begin to discover your purpose. And as you discover your purpose, you begin to have that joy that's inside, knowing that God is in charge and man cannot change that because God's in charge. God is the one. Amen? Well, many people say, but Pastor, why am I going through a hard time? Well, Jeremiah said the same thing. I love this. I got to take time for this. Jeremiah 20:18, he says this. Sound familiar? Why was I ever born? My entire life is filled with trouble, sorrow, and shame. No wonder they called him the weeping prophet. Man, if it ended here, it'd be kind of sad. Ever feel this way? Let's be honest. Have you had times when you had a pity party and it didn't feel so good because nobody came? You know, that would have been perfectly okay. You can understand, oh, woe is me, look at me. Nobody loves me, everybody hates me, I'm gonna go eat worms. But you see, Jeremiah had 32 more chapters to write. And about 30 years of his life were yet to come. He began to see that the circumstances, the trials he went through, were all part of the plan of God that he might proclaim the word to these unfaithful people. Because just 9 chapters later, he writes this. And this is a verse you all know, but I bet you didn't know the first verse I gave you. Remember the first verse. Put the first verse back up. Oh, why was I ever born? My entire life's been filled with trouble, sorrow, and shame. Now, 29, verse 11, this is what God, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, God says to Jeremiah, thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. So stop complaining and saying, woe is me, because I know my thoughts. They're only to give you good things. Hallelujah. A life with purpose. Oh, I tell you, I love it. I love it. I love Jeremiah. Isaiah saw this too. And he says in Isaiah 49:5, and now the Lord speaks, the one who formed me in my mother's womb to be his servant who commissioned me. You see, I know the Lord speaks. God formed me in his womb. Why was I formed in my mother's womb? Why did God create me? He commissioned me. He called me. to be his servant. You've been called by God to be his servant. Amen. That doesn't mean something low, because he says later in the New Testament, I no longer call you my servants, I call you my friends. And his children. Amen. What we need to do is discover what we're created for. The Bible says, delight yourself with the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. You see, as we commit our life to God, our desires become more focused on what's right. I wrote here a note on Susanna Wesley. Some of you may say here, I don't know my purpose. I'm just a mother. Look at Susanna Wesley. Was it 19 children? And her husband, who kept leaving her, and he was a preacher, and ended up in jail at the poorhouse. Now, in those days, they had really smart ideas. If a man couldn't support his family, they put him in a jail where he'd be a poorhouse where he couldn't support anybody. It really helped everyone, didn't it? So her husband's in jail. She has these 19 kids. What does she do? She says, I'm not going to lose my purpose. I'm going to bring every one of them up to be men and women of God. And so her son, John Wesley, changed the course of English history. And her other son, Charles, wrote 1,200 hymns. One, I believe, is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. How many know she found her purpose, even though her life around her didn't look good? Here's the question now. What if we choose our own way? What if we say, I'm going to go my own way? Well, Esther 4:14 says, for if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. Let me quote John Corson, my favorite commentator. He says, even if you choose not to step out, deliverance will come. Mordecai said to Esther, but you miss a glorious opportunity and you'll be destroyed in the process. If you're not interested in God's work, if you'd rather complain about your difficult situation or cruise in your easy one, God will still get his work done, but you will perish, not physically, but the vibrancy of your walk, the joy of your service, and the opportunity and blessing of being used will be absent. You see, this is a volunteer army. In this army of God, God takes volunteers, and you can go anytime you want. But we as a church have to understand something. Everyone is important. Every one of you. I often say in this church, there's not a big God in me and a small God in you. Many people teach that, maybe not directly. We, the leadership, are special. How many know that we're all special? We just have different gifts, different callings, different point. But you see, what happens is that we have been entrusted gifts. Every one of you has at least one spiritual gift, according to my Bible. And let me continue, John Corson. He says, what is the use of having he's talking about first the gifts that are wasted. Because a purpose that isn't fulfilled, a gift that isn't fulfilled is a gift that's wasted. If you have a gift of healing and you're not praying for people, it's a gift that's wasted. And he says, what is use of having an eye or a hand that doesn't serve the entire body? A test of the genuineness of any gift is whether it benefits the body of Christ as a whole or only the possessor. Does it tend to unite the body or divide it? In other words, if you have a gift, does it unite the body or does it divide it? If it's of God, it will unite the body. Does it make members who are different from us feel estranged or fellow members with us, one in the same body? What I'm saying is you have a gift, and we need that gift. And if you don't use that gift, that's a wasted gift. Many people say to me, Pastor, why don't we see greater miracles? One reason is, if the Bible says, according to 1 Corinthians 12, that God has given to every man the manifestation of the Spirit, it says every one of you has at least one of nine gifts. So let's say, like last week we had almost 90 people here. Let's say we had 90 people, And there's 9 gifts, and God divided them evenly. Now, we know he doesn't do it evenly, and some have more than one gift. But let's just say, for the sake of argument, it's even. That would mean 10 of you have a gift of healing. And one of the reasons that people are not healed is that normal people in the church don't rise up to receive the gift God's called them to do. You understand it? That's a diff. Well, anyway, let me go on before I get in trouble. We need you. Apply this to the body of Christ. He says, if the Jews are destroyed, you're destroyed too. What he means is, and continuing what he said here, he says, as a body of Christ, we are linked together. We tend to associate only with those who are doing well. In reality, we ought to care equally about the person who's doing poorly, because the weakest among us affects the rest of us. We need to care about everyone in the body. And in that, that's what we need to do. We need to say, I'm called here to build up this body. I'm called here to be a part. I'm called here that the whole body might grow. But we're so, my ministry, my. It's not my, it's us. You hear me? I love this church, because when someone's been sick in the hospital, I've told you in church, I don't have to go and tell people, can you go visit? I do say to one or two I meet, but mostly I don't say to anybody, because I want people to take initiative. And so many went up to see Hannah at the hospital. They told me, what a church you guys have. Must have been, I don't know, the whole church here this week, they said. I love it, because that is you reaching out, not thinking in the way that we brought up to think of a church. Well, somebody has to direct me, instead of saying, we are all members, how can I encourage my brothers and sisters? Are you with me? Amen. Let me go on. What are we called for today? There's individual calls. Every one of you has a call. Every one of you has a purpose. You need to discover that purpose. Some of you are called. People have come and said, I want to work with missions. One of the calls of this church is that we are a missionary church. We do great mission work. Every year we go and we have pastor conference. We show you some pictures, but you have no concept of what goes on unless you've been there. Where we teach 500 pastors. And these pastors come. Last year we did it, we did a smaller. I think it was 120 pastors. But we love these pastors. We don't come with our own agenda. We just come to bless them and to give them Bibles and teach. That is the goal of this church. We want to help other people. This year, as we've been fasting and praying, the Lord's put in my heart again, we got to do more. I'm praying that we can have some crusades in some countries this year. Amen. I love crusades. But it starts at home by everybody doing their part. Are you with me? It starts by, you would say, I'm called to be an intercessor, intercede. I'm called to win souls. What are you called for? What is the call of this day? Let me give you a couple things that every Christian here is called to do, okay? Are you with me? Number one, to catch the falling. The Bible says, why are you born right now? If you're born in 2020 or 2030 or 1859, or whatever you're born in, it matters, doesn't it? Well, I believe in our day, 2012, these are some of the things you're called to do. 2 Thessalonians 2:3 says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless there's a falling away first. There's a falling away in the church of Christ that's unbelievable today. But you and I are called to catch the falling. We don't dwell on the negative. Oh, there's so many people falling away. We're saying, I'm catching them. Where are they falling? I'm going to go catch them. I'm going to bless them. Oh, amen. I'm there. So many preachers, we go, oh, everyone's falling away. I'm a catcher. Hallelujah. Do you know someone falling? God's called you for this time, maybe for that person, to catch them. Amen. We're also called to light a fire. Matthew 24:12, and because of lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Are we going to weep and cry that there's lack of love in the church and the world? No, we're going to light fires. We're going to be the loving ones. We're going to be the ones who reach out when people misunderstand us, people hurt us, people push. We're going to respond in love because God put us here at this hour, at an hour when love is growing cold, to be bearers of love. Hallelujah. Oh, we're here to light the fire of God's love and revival. And the last thing I want to say on that is Luke 10:12. I believe we're living in the end time. I believe we're end time harvesters. He said, the harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. I believe that God has called us to be harvesters. Amen. We call this church Fisherman's Net, not because we think it's a cool name. Actually, when Joy and I got the name, we saw it blazing upon the side of this building. We came back the next day, it was gone. We can't believe it. It was just like supernaturally done. It was a big, like, barn in an old letters, worn. And we came back, and it was gone, wasn't it, Joy? We couldn't find it. I really believe God's called us to be fishers of men. I believe that your purpose in this end day is to be a fisher of men, to win the lost. Amen. Now, let's go back to you and your destiny. It's important, very important you grab this now. If you want to know your purpose, you want to know your identity, never forget who you are. You're a child of God. You see, one of the most important lessons in Esther was she didn't forget that she was a Jew. She didn't turn her back on her people. She could have said, well, that's part of my old life. I'm not Jewish anymore. I'm the queen of this big country. What she said is, if I perish, I perish, but I'm going to lay down my life for these people. I tell you today, that's what God wants us to remember. Romans 8:15 said, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption, where we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we might be glorified with him. What does it say in that verse? That we're the children of God. She could not ignore that she was a Jewess. You and I cannot ignore that we're children of God. If you want to know your purpose, never forget who you are. Hello? You're a child of the King. Some of you believe it. Some of you say, what in the world? That gospel ain't. I tell you, you're a child of the King. Hallelujah. She knew that she was a child of God first. Esther knew she was a child of God first. You and I are children of God first. That is above everything else. Everything else in this life. Okay, do I really matter is the question today. Do I really matter? Yes! You matter. God loves you. You matter. You matter to God. You matter to this church, and you matter to me. One of the things I want everyone in the church to know, you matter. I can't run, and in fact, my energy level is bad sometimes. I have so many things that I want to do and people I want to go and see, and I end up sleeping in the afternoon sometimes because of my medicine and things. But I tell you, you are loved. If you don't see me like I want to be, you are loved. We care for you. We pray for you. God loves you. He cares for you. And the Bible even says he prays for you, right? It's intercession. Do you matter? You matter. Now look at this. Isaiah 44:2. He says, I am your creator. You were in my care even before you were born. How do you like that? God says, I love you so much. He says, I'm your creator, and you were in my care before you were ever born. What a verse! How could I have been in God's care before I was ever born? I don't understand that. But I do know that God's been trying again and again through this word constantly to say that you matter. That you matter to him very much. To go and think that you do not matter is giving in to the enemy because God says you matter. Psalms 139, the NLT, verse 16 says, you saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. Glory! Look at that, people. You say, well, if that's God laid out, it's really bad. Well, that's because you made it that way. That wasn't God's purpose. Now, notice that God's purpose doesn't mean that you're going to be born into the Kennedy or Rockefeller family, have a silver spoon in your mouth. And how many know that when Esther was born, she was born in adverse situations? But she was born with a purpose in those adverse situations. How do you know that God didn't give you those parents you have because you're the only one that could reach them? How do you know that he didn't give you brothers and sisters like I have some that I'd like to send away to Siberia for a while? But you know, how many know that I'm there for a purpose? It did not happen by accident that I'm there to influence them for the kingdom of God. Amen. Hello. Yes. See, God has always said, I love you. From the beginning in Deuteronomy 32, 10, he said this, talking about Israel, I found him in a desert, and in the wasteland, a howling wilderness. I encircled him. I see that like a hug, right? Like a mother hen. I instructed him, kept him as the apple of my eye, of his eye. Oh, you're the apple of God's eye. Do you know that? Some of you can't start to sing, kid. You're the apple of God's eye. You're loved. You have a purpose. So what's our purpose? What's our purpose? What has God called us to do? You know, the point is 4 verse 15. When Esther comes and you reach this point, people, it will change your life. You apply it to every area of your life where the purposes of God are in conflict with your purpose. Here's what she said. If I perish, I perish. She's saying, I caught my life but lost, like Paul said. She's saying, for the purposes of God, I totally surrender. My time, energy, anything you want belongs to you, God. I'm expendable for you. That's an amazing place to come in your life, where you're saying, God, pour me out as you want it to be. One of the most influential books that you could ever read is called Through Gates of Splendor. And you read about this young man, Jim Elliot. And those of us that were Christians at that time remember the news reports when the bodies of these missionaries were found killed by these Indians. And they found his book, his diary, in his journal from October 28, 1949, says this, one of the best quotes I could ever read. He is of no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain when he could not lose. You know, when they were killed, later the wives went and they interviewed the men who killed their husbands and lived among them and led them all to Jesus. And the Indians who killed these men said, every one of them, in different ways, everyone said that when we killed them, all of a sudden these lights came in the heavens and we heard music. And we looked up the sky to see where this music and these lights were coming from. They went through gates of splendor. That's why it's called that, through gates of splendor. They said, God, I've poured out. My purpose may be short, My purpose may be to pour my life out on this little beach on the side of a river. But God welcomed them into heaven. Now, all the Indians, they became saved because they saw, some saw angels, some saw colored lights, but they all heard this unbelievable music as God welcomed them home to say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. For such a time as this, God has called you. For such a time as this, there's souls to be saved at your workplace. For such a time as this, maybe there's people in your family God has called you to win. For such a time as this, God is calling you to men, women, young people. Maybe God's called you to help like so many do in the nursery or working somewhere. For such a time as this, God has called you to something. For such a time as this, God has placed you in this body to help it mature, to help it grow. For such a time as this, God has called every one of you to a purpose. For such a time as this, to be an influence in a world that's about to enter the great tribulation. Are you fulfilling your call? The greatest joy of my heart, the greatest thing I long for, the desire of my heart is to see the kingdom of God established in our area. You say, "Pastor, what's on your heart? What do you pray for?" I pray that many come to Jesus. Many grow in Jesus. I don't care if they remember me. I care, want them to remember Jesus. On that day we meet him, it's not going to matter all the human recognition. But when someone comes up to you and says, "I'm here because you shared the word of God with me. I'm here because you gave that we could send missionaries. I'm here because you interceded and prayed." For such a time as this, God has called you.